It's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker. So, Marco Jevenpa from the University of Oslo and University of Aalto, so Aalto University from Finland, will talk about batch simulation and uncertainty quantification in Gaussian process surrogate ABC. So, it's your flow.
Okay, thank you, Massi, for the introduction, and I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me to give a talk. So my presentation is about Gaussian process surrogate modeling to resolve certain computational challenges in ABC. Okay, so my talk is based on our recent paper in UAI. But when I was preparing these slides, I realized that it would be also good to review some contents from our earlier paper, which is now published in Bayesian analysis. So if you have read this Bayesian analysis paper, or if you recall my talk in ABC workshop in Edinburgh about 2 years ago, but have not created this newer one. So what is really new this time is now we have a principled approach to parallelize our simulations in this setup. And I'm also presenting a principled approach to quantify the uncertainty in the ABC posterior, which is because we have only a limited number of simulations available here. So this is a joint work with Michael Gutmann, Arius Pleska, and my advisors, Aki Vehtari and Pekka Marttinen from Aalto University. So this is also part of my PhD thesis, which I actually successfully defended last week. So thank you, Umberto Pikini, for acting as an opponent. Okay, so I guess most of you are already quite familiar with Bayesian inference and ABC, but I thought I'd still start from the beginning, mainly to set up some notation and the terminology that I will be using. So our goal is to estimate some parameters theta of a statistical model of interest, and we have a prior PDF and some observed data available. So when the likelihood function is tractable, we can use Bayes' theorem to compute the posterior, and we can then combine it with MCMC or variational inference to actually carry out the inference. However, here we are interested in the case where the likelihood function is intractable, so that we can't really derive its analytical form or evaluate its value. But we can still simulate some pseudo data from the model so that we can use ABC. So the main ingredients of ABC are the discrepancy function that I denote with delta, so that it takes two data sets and outputs a value that tells how similar those data sets are. And the another key parameter is the threshold parameter epsilon. And by the way, I forgot to say that if you have some quick questions, then it would be okay to ask it during the talk. But if you have a bit more complicated or fundamental question, then it might be good to have it in the end. Okay, so the most basic ABC method is perhaps the ABC rejection sampler, where we at each step first sample one parameter from the prior, then use this parameter to simulate one pseudo data set from the model, and finally we accept this parameter as a draw from the ID, also as a IID draw from the approximate posterior if the corresponding discrepancy value is smaller than epsilon. And of course, this ABC rejection sampler can be quite inefficient, and there has been a lot of work on developing more efficient sampling-based methods. But in this talk, we are interested in cases where the computational cost of running the simulation can also be very large, for example, minutes or even hours, so that these standard sampling-based APC methods cannot really be used. And of course, in addition to this computational challenge, there are also other challenges. For example, finding suitable discrepancy or suitable summary statistics to form the discrepancy can often be difficult. And similarly, choosing a good value for the threshold parameter epsilon can also be difficult. But in this talk, I'm mainly concerned with the computational challenges. So standard APC methods target the APC posterior, which is shown in equation 2. And typically, we consider 0,1 type of kernel function pi epsilon, so that we can actually write the ABC posterior, so that it's a proportional to the product of the prior, and the probability that if we simulate at some parameter theta, then the resulting discrepancy evaluation is smaller than epsilon. And the main goal of this line of work is to compute and sample from equation 4, or actually an approximation to equation 4 in a situation where each simulation is very costly, so that we can have, for example, only 1,000 simulations available. So the main idea here is that we treat computing the ABC posterior, as in equation 4 in the previous slide, explicitly as Bayesian inference problem itself. So if you are familiar with probabilistic numerics literature, then the main motivation here is quite similar. So we make the assumption that each discrepancy evaluation is a Gaussian distributed around some unknown function f. And then we realize that under this assumption, if this unknown function f and also the variance of the discrepancy sigma n squared were known, then we would actually, or then we could actually write the ABC posterior as in equation 5. So if I go back to equation 4, so here we had this probability that the discrepancy is smaller than epsilon. So under this Gaussian assumption here, I can write it like this. And then I denote this quantity in equation 5 using pi f abc. And then if I have a tilde, if there's a tilde also there, then I use that to denote the unnormalized version of that density. Okay, and then I give a Gaussian process. Okay, there seems to be a question from Luigi. I guess we can take it here.
Hi. So yeah, quick. Hi. I mean, I hope it's a quick question. Otherwise, maybe you can answer later. So the model that you mentioned with the Gaussian noise, so can be also negative. Why we expect delta to be positive or non-zero negative, right?
Sorry, can you say again?
So the model that you say the statistical model that you presented with the Gaussian noise, so could also be negative, but we expect delta to be non-negative.
Yes, so, so that is a good point. So this discrepancy can be, or it is usually so that it is like non-negative, but I'm still using this GP model to model it.
Okay, so okay, maybe I can ask a bit about it a bit later. Okay, thanks.
Yes, I will get back to it.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, so I put a GP prior on this unknown function f. And then under this Gaussian measurement model, I can then derive, or then we can get a Cp posterior for this unknown function f given dt. So those of you who are familiar with Gaussian process regression, there is nothing really new here. But those of you who are not very familiar, you can just think that it is just a one non-parametric Bayesian way to estimate this unknown function f in a flexible way, which allows us to incorporate some information about the smoothness of this function. So here mt is then the mean function of the Cp, and ct denotes the covariance function of the Cp. And then, because I'm actually not interested in this function f, but actually on the resulting ABC posterior, which is a function of f, then what I actually want to do is that I basically propagate the uncertainty of f, which is presented by this Cp model, through this mapping, so that I can quantify what is my uncertainty in this resulting ABC posterior, because I have only a limited number of simulations available. And of course, we can see that this, if we go back again, we can see that in equation 5, the dependence of this unknown function if f is quite complicated, and of course f is infinite dimensional, so doing this analytically is not possible, but I have a develop a numerical method to do this. So if you want to see the details, you can check section 5 of the full paper. And I could also mention that the mean variance and the quantiles of this unnormalized ABC posterior, however, can be computed analytically. So here is a brief illustration how this now works. So theta is our parameter here, and on y-axis we have the discrepancy value, and then we have our threshold epsilon presented by this blue line, and then these black stars are our discrepancy evaluations. So I fit the Cp surrogate model to that data, and from the Cp I can compute then what is my some estimator for the posterior or the unnormalized posterior, and then I can quantify what is the uncertainty in this ABC posterior, because I have just a limited number of simulations to estimate this quantity. And then I can select new simulation locations so that I am minimizing the uncertainty, so basically this gray area in the figure. So this is the main idea. And then how do I actually choose this simulation locations, and how do I choose the estimator or the point estimator for the ABC posterior? So we use Bayesian experimental design. So L here denotes a loss function that tells basically the penalty of reporting D as our ABC posterior, while the true one is pi ABC. And from here, I can get a Bayes one batch ahead optimal. Okay, we have again a question. But
yes, Antoinette, please go ahead if you have a question.
No, sorry. No question.
Okay. So here I can get the criteria for selecting my simulation location. So in this work, we are now considered the case where I want to run some B simulations in parallel, so that I can take advantage of parallel computing. So in our previous work, we only considered the sequential case where I choose one parameter at a time, so B was one. So if we take a look at this equation 8, we can see with blue color our loss function there, and then we are taking expectation with respect to this unknown function f, given our simulations that far, supplemented with some candidate parameter theta star and corresponding discrepancy evaluations in this delta star. And then I choose this point estimator by minimizing the expected loss. And of course, I don't know what kind of a discrepancy values I get if I simulate at some point theta star. So then I'm also taking the expectation with respect to the distribution of theta star given the delta star given the theta star and dt, if it can be computed from the GP. So this looks a bit nasty, and there are some computational challenges involved in equation 8. So for example, it requires a high-dimensional global optimization. For example, if we have a p-dimensional parameter and our batch size is b, then this product is usually quite large, so that this optimization is hard. But it turns out that we can use greedy optimization here to approximate the result, which then simplifies this high dimensional optimization problem into a series of lower dimensional ones, which is feasible to do. So if we consider L2 types of loss function between the unnormalized posterior and its estimator d tilde, so here I have this simplification that I now target the unnormalized posterior because this allows to get a semi-analytical formulas, then I can show that this optimal point estimator is actually the posterior mean of this quantity, which has this simple formula in equation 9. And then I can also get a fairly simple formula for this loss function that I'm minimizing in equation 10, which is called expected integrated variance. So the main computational challenge here is that we need to integrate over the parameter space. I could also mention that this capital T is Owen's T function, which can be computed efficiently. And then to deal with this integration, we use importance sampling, but I will not go into details here. And then we can do similar analysis also with L1 type of loss function, which leads to expected integrated mean absolute deviation criterion, which has fairly similar formulas. Okay, so here is our algorithm, and I will not describe each part of it, but I could mention that from lines 1 to 4, we are first simulating from the prior to get some initial points to fit our, well, initial GP model, and then the actual algorithm goes from the line 6 to line 16, so that at each iteration we are first fitting the GP, then we are computing the importance sampling weights for approximating the criteria itself, and then on lines 9, 10, and 11 we are then constructing the batch by greedily optimizing this EIV criteria. And once we have got our batch of B points, then on lines 12, 13, and 14 we can then run those simulations in parallel. And once my computational resources have ended and I end up in line 17, I can then, for example, take the point estimator of this unnormalized ABC posterior and plug it into MCMC algorithm. So here is a simple illustration, first in the sequential case where I choose one point at a time. So here the KL is the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the estimated and the true posterior, and TV is the total variation, or the corresponding total variation distance. And these black dots here describe those places where I have simulated already. And then this this figure here shows how does this EIV design criteria look like. So we can now see that once I run some more simulations, I start to get better and better results. And here, after 210 simulations, I have already quite a good approximation. And I can see that most of these evaluation locations have been chosen in the modal area of the posterior, but there are some individual points also elsewhere to see that there is no posterior mass there. And here is an illustration how does this batch evaluations go. So here on the top row, we have first the sequential methods where we choose one simulation at a time. And on the bottom row, we have the corresponding batch evaluations, which have been chosen using this greedy optimization algorithm. And here EIV and EIMAD are those techniques that I described in previous slides. And then this MaxV is an heuristic method which evaluates in such a point in parameter space where the current variance of the unnormalized posterior is highest. And similarly, this MaxMAD method evaluates where the current mean absolute deviation of the unnormalized APC posterior is highest. And here I realized that it might have been better to use name Max or Mad Max because it might have been a bit more exciting. Okay, anyway, what we can see here is that these more heuristic approaches tend to focus these evaluations quite near to the modal area of the posterior. And we can see that the results are maybe not that good and these points are quite clustered, while these more theoretically sound approaches tend to produce, at least intuitively, more clever choices. And we can see that there is also some diversity in the batch points. So these red pluses and x's show the like the two last batches. So we can see that there is some diversity. It doesn't happen that we always end up simulating at the same point. And I think there have been some confusion how does this approach now relate to some other techniques in literature. So here is some summary of that. For example, there is Bayesian optimization, which is a very active topic in machine learning literature. So it is clearly closely related to what I'm doing here. So the model is quite similar, so we are modeling some expensive to evaluate function f, and we assume that we have access to noisy evaluations of that function, and here we have a Gaussian measurement model, and then we put a GP prior on this unknown function f, and indeed the goal is then to find the minimum value of this unknown function f. Then there's also something known as Bayesian quadrature, which is mathematically quite similar to Bayesian optimization, but the main difference is again here on red, so that the quantity of interest is not the optimizer of this unknown function f, but some integral of it. So here g is some known function, usually identity, but it can be, for example, also exponential if we want to take into account that this integrand must be positive. And pi is some known density, for example, Gaussian. And for example, in some cases, it can be shown that the posterior for this unknown integral value if is a Gaussian and its mean and variance can be in some cases computed analytically so that we can quantify our uncertainty about the value of this integral in a probabilistic fashion. Then GPs have also been used for level set estimation and some related goals. So here the main idea is to find some parameters theta so that the corresponding function value will be smaller than some threshold, where we can take this threshold to be zero without loss of generality. And now if we compare this to our Bayesian ABC framework, so we can see that the main difference is now that we are targeting this ABC posterior, which has this formula here. And in fact, we can see that if we were only interested in computing this normalizing constant, then that would be actually a Bayesian quadrature problem, where we choose this where we choose this known function g so that it is this term here. Another difference is that usually in Bayesian optimization, Bayesian quadrature, it is assumed that these evaluations of these unknown functions are noiseless, or the amount of noise is small, while in this ABC case, where the noise actually describes the variability, because the model is stochastic, it's usually much bigger than zero. And usually when I've been presenting this algorithm of mine, so people have asked, how is this different from this really nice Bolfi framework by Michael Gutmann and Jukka Korander? And also, why are we not just using Bayesian optimization here? Especially, why are we not using batch Bayesian optimization? These are, of course, really good questions. So the main difference from Bolfi is that this is now fully probabilistic, while in Bolfi approach, mainly point estimation was used. And we have also now a better theoretical approach to select these evaluations instead of counting on techniques that are actually taken from Bayesian optimization literature. And I think I'm a bit behind from my timetable, so I will only explain this briefly. So there is something called lower confidence bound criterion that has been previously used in this setting. It has this fairly simple formula where MT is the GP mean function and ST is the corresponding standard deviation. And these are computed for the ABC discrepancy in this ABC setting. So there are some difficulties that I see in using LCP in this case. For example, LCP doesn't depend on the prior or the threshold, where the ABC posterior does. And that seems like a bit problematic. And also, in practice, this LCP can get stuck evaluating near the mode. And then some heuristics needs to be used, which seems also a bit problematic. There's also some nice theory for LCP on how should you choose this trade-off parameter beta t, but that also, that is developed for the Bayesian optimization setting, and it doesn't really say much about the ABC case, which is also quite problematic. And it seems to me that it's quite difficult to generalize LCP to some other AP surrogate modeling cases. For example, if you were to model your vector of summary statistics, for example, using multi-output GP, then it seems that LCP cannot be used in that setting, or at least there's no natural generalization of LCP for that setting. But on the other hand, the good thing about LCP is that it's quite simple to compute, and it has a much simpler formula than the EIV that I saw before. There is also a curious connection that if the prior is basically uniform, then the point chosen by LCP when applied in this ABC setting, with some trade-off parameter beta t, is actually the same as if we were maximizing the phi beta t quantile of this unnormalized ABC posterior, and this holds for any epsilon. So this suggests to me that we could actually define LCB differently in this ABC setting using this kind of a connection, and then this actually makes it to depend on the prior, but I will not go into further details here. Okay, Michael, please ask.
Yeah, I just wanted to quick, can you go back a slide? I just want to briefly make a comment. So I completely agree with what you're saying here about the problematic and the advantages that you point out, of course. Just really for the audience, so I realized with time that many people kind of reduce a paper to its title. And I chose here a rather concrete title, namely Bayesian optimization for likelihood for inference. But when you actually read the paper, it really proposes like a framework for probabilistic modeling of the discrepancy plus decision making under uncertainty. And only in one section, I explain how to implement that framework with Bayesian optimization. So audience, please don't reduce the paper to just Bayesian optimization. That's all. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Michael, for the comment. I totally agree with this. And I just wanted, this is exactly why I wanted to talk about this, because I have seen a lot of confusion between the Bayesian optimization when it's applied to this ABC context.
Yeah, I agree. And I think that
some people now clear things up to some extent, at least.
Yeah, I think then also, right, the GP model that is used is of course like a meta parameter as well. Yeah, okay. I give you back the floor.
Yeah, thanks. Okay, so here is a further illustration about what might happen when you apply this LCB. A bit like in this Polfi paper in the case of ABC. So this is not really something that happens every day. So here there is a conflict, a kind of a conflict between the prior and the likelihood. So here what happens is that because these Bayesian optimization techniques, target in the area where the likelihood is large, but in this case, because also the prior contains some information, we can see that the true posterior is somewhere between the likelihood and the resulting posterior, and it happens that all these evaluations, however, end up in the areas with the high likelihood, and so that we basically need to extrapolate to get this estimated posterior. While on the other hand, this expected integrated variance works as it should. So you can see that most of these evaluations are concentrated around the true posterior. And we can also see that, which is a known problem with Bayesian optimization methods, that you end up evaluating in the boundaries, at least sometimes. And I would think that many of these evaluations are actually quite redundant here. On the other hand, if we take a look at this EA case, we can see that there are only a few evaluations on the boundaries, which seems like a good property in this case. Okay, then I briefly describe some results. So here x-axis shows the iteration of our algorithm, so basically you can think this is a proxy for wall time, and y-axis basically shows how good the approximation is. So we can now see that when we increase the batch size b, we need less iterations to reach basically as good results as if we are running in this sequential case. So batch strategies are certainly useful. And we can see also that we don't exactly get to the zero. So this is exactly because the GP model is not a perfect model for the discrepancy. It could be because, for example, we are not taking into account discrepancy must be positive. But of course, there are also other possibilities how this GP might be misspecified. And here is an illustration of this uncertainty quantification aspect. So here on the y-axis, we have the ABC posterior expectation for these two parameters of this model. And this red line is the ABC posterior computed with extensive simulations with ABC MCMC. And we can see that when we run more iterations, our uncertainty gets smaller, and eventually we converge somewhere quite close to the true value, but well, not exactly, because the GP was not a perfect model in this case. So that if we were to stop our algorithm at some point because we don't have more computational resources available, we could at least in principle see how much uncertainty there is left about this posterior expectation. And here are similar results with a bit more complicated model where we have three unknown parameters. Again, we can see that with bigger batch sizes, we require less wall time. But we can also see that we can't make this batch size arbitrarily arbitrarily big, because when we increase the batch size, then we can see that we are not getting that much improvement anymore. And we can see from here that the results are fairly good here, especially considering that we have used only a few hundred simulations. And here is an illustration of this uncertainty quantification aspect. So in the case of this bacterial infections model, so that we can see that here the black lines represent the uncertainty in this ABC posterior marginals. So we can see that when we run some more simulations, the uncertainty gets smaller. And here I just saw this quickly. So we can see that the non-negativity of the discrepancy does not seem to be a huge problem here. And we can see that they are fairly close to Gaussian. So these are the histograms, so the distribution for the discrepancy near their true values for these two models that I considered, and also for a third model that I'm not showing here. Okay, then I proceed to the summary. So I showed how computing ABC posterior can be treated itself as a problem of Bayesian inference, a bit similar fashion to has been done with some other numerical analysis tasks in probabilistic numerics literature. So the main idea was to use GP surrogate to model the discrepancy, but of course many other quantities could also be modeled, and the same principle could be used. And we use Bayesian experimental design to select these evaluation locations in a semi-optimal manner. And I also showed how to use how to quantify the uncertainty in, for example, ABC posterior expectations as in the Lorentz model in a probabilistic fashion. And all in all, we obtained quite reasonable ABC posterior estimates, at least in small dimensions with less than 1,000 simulations, and we saw that this framework is well suited for parallel simulations. And of course, as one might expect, some price to pay for being able to do ABC inference when you have a really limited number of simulations available. So first of all, fitting GPs or optimizing the design criteria is not cheap. So this is useful for costly models only. If it takes like several seconds, minutes, or more time to run simulation. There's also some additional approximation error because it's usually so that the GP is not a perfect model for the discrepancy. And then this uncertainty quantification approach itself requires some simulation, so it's not completely satisfactory solution, although it seems to be somewhat useful nevertheless. We also assume that a suitable discrepancy is already given to us, but if this is not the case, then it remains unclear how to proceed then, or is this then hopeless task. We also assume that this threshold was predefined, or in some simulations I updated it adaptively, which seems to work, but there might be some better way to set this threshold in this framework. And finally, I could point out that currently there's no rigorous theoretical analysis on the convergence of these algorithms. So if we run infinitely many simulations, and if we have some technical conditions on the GP model, then do we eventually get the true ABC posterior exactly remains unclear. Although intuitively, I would think that it must be the case. So thank you for your attention.
So indeed, thanks a lot for your talk. Let's give some virtual applause. And everyone, please use the hand raise functionality to ask questions. Okay, Lorenzo has a question, so please unmute yourself and go ahead.
Hi, thank you so much for the talk. I just have a very quick question. If you go back to your slide 30, I think, where you had the example on Lorenz model, I didn't really get, maybe it's not slide 30, yeah, it's...
this one or the previous one?
The previous one, please.
Yeah.
Yeah, just I didn't really get what is on the on the above graph, on the y-axis you have the total variation, but yes. Is it with respect to what?
So this is the total variation distance between the estimated ABC posterior and then the corresponding true ABC posterior, which
all
has
right,
been
sure. Okay,
computed using like extensive simulations using ABC MCMC. So this doesn't, because the true posterior is unknown for this model, so I can't compare to that either.
Yeah, this is why I was confused. Okay, thanks so much.
Yeah, thanks for the question.
Any other questions? Perhaps while people are thinking, I would have a question, or maybe, whether you can clarify. So you said like you used a greedy procedure to get the batches of the acquisitions. So
yes.
Can you comment on the optimality of the greedy approach? So is it like a submodular function and greedy is actually, in a sense, a good approach, or? Does it work empirically only?
So it seems that this, if we go back, so unfortunately so we can see from here that so it is probably not a submodular function. So we can see that the dependence of this theta star is quite complicated, so it seems quite difficult to analyze in this case whether it is submodular or not. It might be also weakly submodular, but then from that, the problem that follows from that would be then weaker. But in any case, it seems quite difficult to analyze whether this is submodular or not, but I would think it is not. So it is, so this is mainly like empirical result that it gets, it gives much better results. We can however see that this is a decreasing function in a sense that if I increase, if I put more points, or if I include more points, then this this criterion gets smaller. So that gives me at least some idea or some confidence that this greedy approach might be a good approach, but it doesn't lead to any bound as far as I know.
Okay, thanks. Any further comments? Maybe it seems I have a lot of space in asking questions. So actually on this slide exactly, you say like, well, you also looked into the L1 loss
yes.
between the pi tilde f and d tilde and the L2. So what other loss functions do you think could be reasonable to explore? And so A, which other loss functions would be interesting? And B, what about the feasibility in deriving then, well, something equivalent to equation 10 that could be minimized?
Yeah, I really haven't thought about other loss functions that I'm now using here. So I would think that this both L1 and L2 already seem to be quite explorative, but it's not that clear to me. If I choose a specific loss function, how does it actually kind of a transform into those points or their locations, or whether it's like an explorative or not? And the reason why I chose these are, of course, I thought that they are a kind of a good one size fits all type of solution, which also then lead to semi-analytical formulas that we can compute. But I don't think that there might be like many choices that you could make so that you can so that you get analytical formulas here. I'm not sure if this completely answered your question.
Probably not, but I think it's also, I wasn't really expecting a complete answer because it's kind of an open-ended question. And of course, indeed, it gives a lot of research opportunities to hear, think about what other loss function might be interesting.
So if we were interested, for example, only on some tail events of the ABC posterior, then I would think that those, that kind of, if you design a loss function that somehow relates to that, then it might make things more explorative, I would think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think already now, right, actually six small unnormalized posteriors don't really enter that much into the loss function, right? So one would actually think the I tilde 2 is kind of dominated by the modal area, perhaps.
Yes.
But in the simulations, actually, you have seen that it, unlike the heuristics, it does actually explore the tails, right?
Yes.
So do you how do you have an explanation for how to understand that?
At least if I think about this heuristic, so-called uncertainty sampling approaches, which evaluate where the current uncertainty is highest. So because estimating those tail events is quite hard and you need a lot of simulations, so it is maybe not that surprising that you end up evaluating quite a lot in those places, or those modal areas, because there is a kind of a connection there, but it's not that easy to see or explain. But the variance tends to be highest in those areas where the posterior is highest, and those correspond to those areas where the tail probability is largest. So it kind of follows from there.
Okay, so I guess one could look at like the coefficient of variation, perhaps, where you would normalize it somehow. So
that would be possible in principle, at least.
Okay, but Adrian has a question, so please go ahead.
Thank you very much. This is more a conceptual question. I'm not really from this field, so I would just, if there is time, ask you to again clarify the interpretation of this Gaussian process model. In terms of the statistical model for which we actually want to do the inference by ABC and the true data generating process. So maybe to put this together, my question is it correct that this GP model kind of captures the model error, or do I...
GP captures only the error. So it captures the error in this unknown function F, because we only have a limited computational resources, so that we can only run a limited number of like a forward simulations of the simulation model. So it doesn't really capture the, in case that's what you meant, it doesn't really capture the error that the simulation model itself might be, for example, like a misspecified, or that we have only a limited number of simulations to fit the simulation model in the first place.
Yeah, so I think that was actually my question.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is that, so first of all, we have this ABC posterior that shows what is the uncertainty about this simulation model parameters, because we have a limited number of data. And then on top of that, we have the second level of Bayesian inference, which basically allows us to quantify what is the uncertainty in this ABC posterior itself, because we have a limited number of computational resources for performing the inference itself.
Yeah. Does this mean also that the gap in this convergence plot you showed is really only due to misspecification of the GP model, not of the statistical model we do?
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Because thank you very much.
No problem. Thanks for the question.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks. So if there are no further questions, I think we are just in time to thank the speaker again. And then in 2 weeks' time, we have our next presentation, which I think is David Frazier. So thank you again, Marco, for your presentation.
Thanks.
Just a quick notification. Excellent is writing. David will speak at 10:30 a.m. UK time, so it's 1 hour earlier than usual to make it more feasible for him from Australia. Cheers a lot. Thanks again, Marco.